The first reading I ever did publicly was for Poets and Players about 10 years ago, so it feels very fitting and lovely to be back here. And on that day I read with my friend Laura Webb, who recently won the Manchester Poetry Prize. And I thought it would be a nice start to read a poem I wrote about her a few years after we did our first meeting together. And it's called Sleep Sister. And of course it bothers me greatly that I can't know the quality of the light where you are, how your each day pans out, how the breeze lifts the dry leaves from the street, or how the street pulls away from the rain. Last week I passed a tree that was exactly you in tree form, with a kind look and tiny sub-branches, tiny sub-branches like your delicate wrists. 6 years ago we were lying in a dark front room on perpendicular sofas, so hungover that our skin hurt to touch. How did we always manage to be heartbroken at the same time? I could chop, de-seed and roast a butternut squash for dinner in the time it took you to shower. Steam curtained the windows, whiting out the rain which hit the house sideways. One of us, though I forget who, said, "Do you think women are treated like bowls waiting to be filled with soup?" And the other one said, "Of course." Now the world is too big, and it's sinking and rising and stretching out its backbone. The rivers are too wild, the mountains are so, so old, and it's all laid out arrogantly between us. My friend, how long do you stand staring at the socks in your drawer, lined up neat as buns in a bakery, losing track of time and your place in the world, in the custody light of the morning? On the train on the way up, I was thinking of an excuse to read this next poem, which was in an anthology of Simpson's poems and artwork. And I thought, oh, it was Valentine's Day fairly recently, that seems like a good excuse, even though it's really bleak. It's written in the voice of Milhouse, basically. So, you know, I feel bad because I could have given him any of the life he wanted. I kept him in the house. This is The Lemon of Troy. On our mission to retrieve the stolen lemon tree, I imagined the tree was Lisa. All her wonderful yellow, the slope of her shoulders, the inevitable breast. Her being the reason I ever became more than myself. People had hidden inside wooden horses as I had imagined living inside of her. Years now and there have been others. They smudge my memory, their flat faces, their alien shapes, the soft and pathetic sex we made. I remember how I would prefer to look at the reflection of the sky in her saxophone than the actual sky. How the dark at the base of its neck was the only kind I wasn't afraid of. This is how I've spent my life, in the mirror image of things. I'm allergic to honey, wheat, dairy, non-dairy, and my own tears. For some people, this is a punchline. The red blisters shining under my eyes. Those people always win. I play second banana. I was born to do it. Evenings are blue and cold. I eat dinner like a Puritan, not gratefully or with an eye to heaven, but meanly denying myself. How else can you learn to live with a want that crouches in your centre? I'm sure there are no more great days. Just days. Sometimes it's hard to breathe through the hours of cruel offerings. How egg yolks split, how clouds ruin the sky, how life gave you lemons and no Lisa, how pips grow inside things, making them not perfect. I to read a longer prose poem that's quite new and I haven't ever read before. I don't have much to say about it, I don't think. It's called The Apparition of a Black Cat Appears to Leap Out from the Flames. One Sunday, sitting at the table working, facing out to the street, I saw a black cat on the pavement at the foot of a tree. It was lying on its side. That the cat wasn't resting in a sunny spot made the scene instantly strange. The ground the cat was lying on looked clean, as did the cat. A bus went past at speed and the cat didn't move. Several cars followed shortly after. It was certainly dead. I knew that no one would come out to tend to a dead cat on a Sunday. The sun filtering through the windows caught the particles in the air which roamed. People noticed the cat as they walked past and some paused, but nothing about the scene demanded action. It was like a painting. The people observed and continued to move. I looked up from my work often. Some time passed and the light began to fade. Taking my keys, I left the flat and walked slowly across the road. I realised in a shooting moment that the cat was the largest dead thing I'd ever seen. I'd seen badgers and pheasants and rabbits smashed on the road when I left the city, and I saw the shape of a dead cow as I passed a field, but nothing with a name. I didn't want to be near it. I stopped about a metre from the cat and peered at it, as if looking over the edge of a cliff. It didn't have a collar, which was a relief, meaning I didn't have to poke my fingers around its little neck. I was glad that its eyes were closed and their guts were visible. It was a cold, steamy, grey day now, almost purple. A woman in her pyjamas appeared at the top of the steps, outside a nearby house. I said to her that I thought the cat was dead. She said yes, it had been there for hours. No one would come out on a Sunday. I said there was no collar. She said she had seen the cat around and thought it belonged to a household further down the road. She didn't know which one exactly. The road went on for about a kilometre, hundreds of houses. I had never seen the cat before, as far as I could remember. I more often left the flat and turned right towards the station where a white cat sits on the wharf by the entrance like a totem and is petted by everyone. This cat from a household to the left of my flat was not known to me. We exchanged one or two additional remarks each, speculating that the cat had been hit by a vehicle, gently enough not to die right away, walked to the side of the road and lay down there. We looked at each other, the woman and I, our faces communicating that there was nothing to be done and we would both now turn our backs on the cat. Back inside, I made a tea and took my place again at the table. I looked up from my work minutes later. It was almost dark. A cardboard box had been placed over the cat, though I had seen no one approach. I felt easier knowing that no one would accidentally tread on or kick the cat, which would be hard to discern from the pavement in the dark, and that no one would see it and be upset. But I also worried that the cat's household, returning from a day out, would go looking for the cat, now hidden. I left the table for some time, possibly to get something to eat, and returned to see that the tea lights had been placed around the box and lit. This gave the scene the feeling of a shrine, and also seemed fittingly respectful of the cat and its spirit as was, though I admit I laughed when I saw them. The streetlights on the road were often faulty, and the one nearest the cat had failed to come on. It was lit from the left and right, with the half light, just about reaching it from lights nearby. The wind picked up, and the candle flames were going flat to the white backs. The next time I looked up, they had gone out. I think I'll read just two more. It was a great relief to me a couple of weeks ago when quite stressed when everything's dead out there. So seeing things kind of popping back felt very hopeful. So these last two poems I associate in some way with spring or growth and plants. The first one in a very obvious way. I wrote a poem for a project that my friend Crispin Best runs, where a writer or an artist is allocated a year and they can write about whatever happened in that year in any way they like, as loosely as they like. And I came across a botanist. I had some year in the 18th century, and I found a botanist, and I read a lot about him and then found him not really interesting, and then clicked on a link that mentioned his wife in an article, and her name was Nizinska, and she was a painter of miniatures. So I basically ran with the idea of taking absolute liberties of their relationship. It's called Apples Are Water Air. My husband, the botanist, he dreams green. If you dropped an apple into the ocean, imagine it could wash up on an island with nocturnal trees. The particular way branches branch resemble the pathways through the heart. These are the things he says in the empty space before sleep. How tedious to be a man, so perpetually unchallenged. He is making his own kind of language only the plants comprehend. I paint flowers in miniature. He tells me this is theft, a liberty, and not only that, preservation, which is contrary to nature. I find joy only in the shrinking. Like a strawberry, he presents his pips on the outside. They are so numerous. At night, the shadows of his hands move like leaves on the wall. He is a man made up of dark corridors, but he isn't a man at all. You can't tell me the carnivorous plant doesn't have a brain and therefore a heart. Perhaps now I'm talking about myself. In his greenhouse, he is so far away, like a man underwater, a man in a block of ice. When I dream, his mouth becomes a pea-sized hole, and I press the tip of my little finger to it. I eat him whole. In the immaculate garden, the sunflowers rotate with the sun. Thank you for listening. Thank you for having me. It's always a delight to be in Manchester. Even if it's for 7 hours, I think is what I've done today, which is ridiculous. But yeah, so this is the last poem. Thank you again. This is called Sacrament. I basked in the protection of the Lord. Debbie saw angels, a gift barely bestowed, and a weight to bear, being as it was that she saw demons also. Our lives as we knew them were pushed up from below and down on from above, waiting in the temporary middle, and all of it spilling over the lines for Debbie. I prophesied through my dreams in which Leah's eyelashes grew back, a cat was strung up outside the church. Our gifts, once identified, had to be cultivated through time spent in conversation, the reading of certain texts, a kind of watering. The essentials of Christian iconography are a geography of wounds, clean lines, a basin of water, Satan presenting in the curve of the apple, the hoop of the snake. You can stop prayer like turning off a tap. It doesn't even drip. My dreams now are full of the impossible. My grandfather's brain rewiring, his voice filling his throat, the shiny leaves of my umbrella tree placing themselves on my body as I sleep. God is not real. I grieve for the grapevine that I find to be ripped from my garden wall, the row of trees felled when I return from work. God is not real. The sky is wide open through the glass doors. The birds seem a sort of pale blue, as does everything. I wish for the gift of multiplication as I propagate my plants. From something comes something, then more. You don't even have to ask.